1.
Factors such as cost and function influence the design of a bridge.
2.
It's important that humans dispose of their waste in appropriate ways.
3.
If you are unable to complete the task in time, please notify me by email.
4.
The financial report for the last quarter will be available this afternoon.
5.
Extra seminars will be scheduled to assist you with revision.
6.
Please switch off all electronic devices when you are attending a conference session.
7.
It is important that you work as a team on this project.
8.
The study showed that people's mood can be affected by news and weather reports.
9.
Detailed analysis of population growth has revealed some alarming predictions.
10.
Please note that the college laboratories will be closed for cleaning next week.
1.
In today's lecture, I'm going to talk about changes in air pollution since the middle of the last century and what has created these changes. So, by the 1950s, air pollution was very visible, with frequent thick black fogs known as smogs in many large cities around the world. The main source of this pollution was from factories, and it caused severe health problems. For example, a particularly severe smog in London in 1952 caused over 4,000 deaths. Obviously, something had to be done. And in 1956, a Clean Air Act was introduced in Britain. This addressed the pollution from factories, and the smog soon disappeared. However, as you know, these days air pollution is still a big issue. The main difference between now and the 1950s is that you can't see it. It's invisible. Also, the main source of pollution now is from cars and lorries. And although these don't produce visible signs, this air pollution is still a significant risk to health. And one of the key factors in the rise of this type of pollution is that we have all become much more vehicle dependent. There are far more cars and lorries, trains and planes than in the 1950s. And this is now the main source of air pollution around the world.
2.
Okay, to help you with your research, I just wanted to give you some tips today on using focus groups. These are groups of people that you get together to find out about their opinions and attitudes. For example, to review a piece of work, or just basically provide some collective input to help you with whatever you're researching. First of all, how large should a focus group be? Well, I would say that an ideal number of participants is around 6 or 7. If it's any bigger, what quite often happens is they break into side conversations and the focus is lost. If it's any smaller, you may not get the range of views that you need to get a really good discussion. Secondly, it's important that you have a moderator for the group who's able to facilitate and guide the discussions. The moderator must ensure that everyone participates and stop anyone dominating. And also, the moderator needs to make sure that the discussions don't go off in the wrong direction. And thirdly, in order to help the group focus on what's required, some basic materials should be used, particularly to kick-start the discussions. This may be in the form of pictures, photos, diagrams, graphs, etc., and will help the group to understand the context of what needs to be discussed.
3.
Hello, everyone. Today's lecture is about setting up a website. I'm going to be focusing on things that you need to consider to ensure your website really adds value to the people using it. So, there are three main areas you need to think about. The first and most important thing is who is your target audience. When you're creating a new website, you really need to think about who the users are and what information they'll be looking for. What we do when we set up websites is to group users based on their needs. So, for a website in the academic community, for example, we may have groups such as researchers and administrators, and this helps us design the site and add information that is relevant to each group. The second point is accessibility. The main thing here is to ensure your website can be found. And you can do this by making sure it can be reached from areas on the web where your target audience are also active. So this may mean providing links on other websites or maybe using social media. And thirdly, retention. Making sure your target audience return to your website regularly. You do this by ensuring it gives them a reason to come back, so it's important to keep the site up to date and make sure it provides the latest news and interesting information and so on.
One.
Which section of a train timetable will tell you what time your train leaves?
2.
What do we call the list of steps that tell you how to put something together?
Three.
What do we call the meeting where an employer asks a potential employee questions about their work experience?
Four.
What desk should you go to when you first arrive to stay at a hotel?
Five.
What is the job title of someone who designs buildings?
Six.
What term is used for the amount of money you pay a landlord for living in their house or apartment?
Seven.
What do we call the first meal of the day?
Eight.
What word is used for someone who watches a sports event?
Nine.
What object would you use to climb up to the roof of a house?
Ten.
If you don't feel like eating, what do we say you don't have?
1.
Technological nature. You may have heard this term. It's a term used to describe a picture of a natural scene that's been produced using computer graphics, so that basically it isn't a real view, say of a garden or field. It's a virtual one. It's a picture that looks like a real scene. Now, looking at scenes of nature is known to have an effect on people's health and well-being. So, for someone who's ill, for a patient in a hospital, does a virtual view of a garden have the same impact as a real one? Does it have the same beneficial effects when you look at it? Because that would be good. Well, if you test this out, if you put a group of people in a room with a real view and another group of people in a room with a virtual view, an unreal view, you can see what happens when they get stressed. If you give both groups a task that is slightly stressful and increases their heart rate, and what you'll find is that the people who have the real garden scene outside their window to look at, their heart rate goes back to normal more quickly than those of the people in the other group who only have a virtual view to look at. So, yes, there is a difference. People's recovery from stress is faster in the room with the real view.
2.
In criminal trials, memories are basic, a critical feature of proceedings. Both sides of the legal team, prosecution and defense, are likely to rely to some extent on witnesses and on what they can recall of events that led up to or indeed formed part of the criminal act. Now, it's been well established in various circles that memory can be unreliable, particularly if new information is introduced in cross-examination that hasn't been presented up until that point. New facts that witnesses were unaware of. A lot of research has been done to test the effects of this, and it can be very problematic. For example, if you show a group of subjects a video of a crime, then you get someone else to read them an account of the same crime, but adding in information, be it ideas or objects that weren't present on the video. What researchers have found is that when the subjects are asked to retell what they saw on the video, they too include a number of things that were never there. In other words, the introduction of new information in a court of law is very likely to skew or distort a witness's memory of the event.
1.
Last week we looked at urban regeneration and some of the consequences of this, one of which was the relocation of people from urban to suburban areas to largely allow them a better standard of living, because housing is cheaper in the suburbs, so they have more disposable income. But they have to commute, and commuters need rapid transport to get them from A to B. So subway construction is, well, it's booming in some parts of the world. It's clearly being seen as the answer to the type of migration that I've just mentioned. It often gets huge public support because, well, if a subway is going to help you have a better lifestyle, then what's there to argue about? Well, quite a lot, actually. For a start, in order to go ahead with a major project of this kind, you need to be absolutely sure that the ground, and more to the point, what lies beneath the ground, can support underground transport. And to address questions like that, engineers have to be really experienced, really knowledgeable about the local area, water levels, land formation, and so on. And those key issues are what I want to focus on today. Passengers don't think about construction. They trust other, better qualified people to do it for them. And governments have to choose these people very carefully.
2.
In places where there's been serious community tensions, I mean, Brickendon's a good example of this, there were 250 reported incidents there in 2009, often to do with neighbours and arguments, but criminal activity too. And the police will tell you that if you leave residents to sort things out for themselves, the number of incidents rises, it doesn't fall. So the local council realised that they had to do something. So they went round to people's houses and met them and their neighbours and talked to everyone and got a general idea of what the local concerns were. If there were extended families involved, they looked at those particular families more closely and all the relatives and got some of the family intervention services to talk to them. And there were some very positive results. I mean, you can pick out the hotspots, you know, the main areas for crime. But the hotspots don't tell you what causes the crime in the first place, and so don't address the issues. So this proactive, more direct approach by the council worked well. And this was followed up with other quite practical solutions like cleaning up the area, getting rid of debris in alleyways and just making the place somewhere more agreeable, more livable.
1.
Learning a language in the classroom is never easy, and quite frankly, it's not the way that most people would choose to learn if they had other options. Having said that, there are plenty of reasons for keeping languages on the school curriculum. For one thing, a fair number of students go on to take jobs in business and commerce that require a basic knowledge of a second language. When you talk to young employees in top companies, it seems that they had a career plan from the start. They were motivated to find additional things to put on their CVs, and of course, language is one of those added but significant extras.
2.
The assignment that I'm going to set for the holiday period is one that we've given students for a number of years. It's quite practical and will allow you to get out and about. It's no good being shut up in your rooms all the time. It does have a written element too. Basically, it's our data gathering exercise, and there are two choices with regard to how you collect the data. We'll go through those in a moment. I'm also going to give you a link to an internet site that is, well, it's critical that you review this before you do anything, as it provides a lot of guidance on data presentation, both in terms of how you plot it, its diagrammatic form, and also its description, which has to be clear.
1.
It's been reported recently that some business schools have decided to make changes to students' grades by increasing them by 10%. This means that a C grade automatically becomes a B and a B grade automatically becomes an A under the new grading system. And the change is retrospective, which means that it applies to all grades that have been achieved since the school's current grading system, which was introduced in 2007, has been in place. Now, there are at least 8 business schools who've changed their grading levels, and they decided to award their graduates higher grades so they would be more attractive in the highly competitive job market. However, changing grades like this has been criticized by the academic and business communities because many people think the grades have been falsely exaggerated and don't reflect the true ability of the student. In fact, many employers realize when a school has made adjustments to students' grades, and so there is no real benefit in doing this. Lifting the grades may even be damaging to the students, because employers may believe that the graduates were given the high grades when they didn't deserve them.
2.
Urban development is the first thing I wanted to talk about here in Perth. Urban development is going on at a great pace, and the standard approach here in Western Australia is for suburban development to happen at the outer edges of the city. You have suburbs slowly spreading out into areas that are cleared, and this is eating into both areas of native bushland and land that used to be used for farming, for agricultural purposes. The debate here is that, on one side, there's the idea that we need more housing. We have a housing shortage in Western Australia, and suburban expansion is essential. Suburban expansion on the edges of the city is cheaper and easier to do than building more homes within the city, even though it's recognised it creates lots of problems with infrastructure and so on. On the other side of the debate, people say that urban sprawl is destroying bush and, consequently, the natural wildlife that exists there, and that it's too easy for developers to ignore these facts.
1.
So it seems that, well, despite the fact that more couples are childless and more people are working in the cities, the pull to the suburbs has continued. Over 50% of Americans, that's about 158 million, live in the suburbs now. While in 1990, that figure was around 48%. That's actually a difference of 40 million. Rural areas, on the other hand, have not seen the same pattern at all. Populations have declined over the past 20 years, and now only 16% of our nation lives there.
2.
Actually, the word malaria means bad air in Italian, and centuries ago, that's what people thought caused this very infectious disease.
And who can blame them, really? Who can blame them for making that false connection? Who'd have thought that a tiny insect like a mosquito could cause so much sickness?
Yes. More surprising, perhaps, is the fact that it's taken scientists so much time since then to come up with a cure.
Well, that's what we're going to talk about now, because it does seem that this is now becoming a real possibility.
1.
As I mentioned last week, we're going to look today at fiction writing, writing stories, and in particular at authors who have a reputation for creating characters in their books who are known as unreliable narrators. Now, what does that mean exactly? Well, originally in the 19th century, it tended to simply mean that as a reader, you just couldn't trust what the narrator of a story was telling you. This might have been because they were not giving you important information, or because they themselves, as a character in their own story, lacked some kind of personal insight. In later works of literature, this unreliability was used by authors more deliberately, with the direct intention of making a story more complicated for a reader to understand, perhaps a crime novel or a thriller. Nowadays, there's a lot more humour in unreliable narration, and it's often used to make first-person characters enjoyable to read about. So, what all that tells us, as a general starting point, is that this type of narration...
2.
When you first examine something under a microscope, say a leaf from a plant, you're amazed at how much detail there is, and it's detail that you simply cannot see without magnification. And what you can see with the naked eye becomes suddenly huge under the lens. How big everything looks is astonishing, but it's also amazingly intricate. Suddenly, it's as if another world has opened up in front of your eyes, and you think, hey, I hadn't realized that something so small, so tiny, could be so...
1.
It seems we now know more about outer space than we do about the Earth's core. This is because temperatures are so high at the center of the Earth that human beings have not been able to take a close look at it. However, new methods of analysis may soon change all that. The seismic waves created by earthquakes and volcanic eruptions penetrate the Earth's layers at different speeds. It is now hoped that by studying these waves, scientists will be able to make new discoveries and solve some of the mysteries of the internal structure of the Earth.
2.
Many species of birds cover long distances during their seasonal migration to warmer climates. But how successful are they? And do birds that get lost on their route ever manage to find their way back? Much research has been conducted into how birds navigate, and the results show that age is a significant factor. Young birds usually just carry on if they lose their migratory path and thus fail to reach their destination, whereas older, more experienced birds will generally be able to find their original route and continue successfully on their journey.
1.
You should draw your graph on a separate page.
2.
Some young people find city life rather stressful.
3.
Weather patterns have changed significantly over the past 200 years.